So how do you go about, you know, making these devices? You know, just follow the conventional semiconductor fabrication, which is used by electronics companies across the world. One difference the nano research community has been pursuing is, instead of using silicon in the form of a thin film, you know, that's what is commonly done by, you know, companies like Intel and Samsung and TSMC in Taiwan and every other company. They all use silicon in the form of a thin film. That's what has been happening in the last, you know, 40 years or so. Whereas in the case of the BioFET, the nanotechnology community has replaced the silicon thin film, you know, with the silicon nanowire. Okay, the silicon nanowire is a one-dimensional analog of the, you know, two-dimensional thin film. These nanowires can be as small as, you know, 10 nanometers. You know, they provide large surface area. The advantages of nanomaterials in sensing, it is something that I covered earlier on in another lecture. So here the device fabrication, you know, follows a typical scheme employed by semiconducting companies, with the exception of the silicon structure itself. Instead of thin film, it is a nanowire. Finally, you know, the gate region now has a reservoir. Okay, that is something that you don't need in the conventional semiconductor chip. But here you need some kind of a, you know, reservoir, which is made out of the photoresist, because that reservoir is the one that's going to keep, you know, one drop of blood or one drop of urine or one drop of whatever, you know, liquid that contains, you know, the target of interest. So the device structure here is the silicon nanowire based, you know, BioFET. On the left that you see the source and then the, you know, the drain. There is a reference electrode that you see on the right side of the cartoon. So typically, the silicon channel has, you know, 10 to 20 parallel nanowires. So that is your silicon, you know, nanowire, you know, BioFET. Instead of having the nanowires as a straight nanowire, you can also arrange these nanowires in the form of a hexagonal or honeycomb, you know, structure, or the so-called, you know, chicken wire structure. Because the advantage of the honeycomb structure is it offers, you know, more mechanical stability, you know, compared to the silicon nanowire. Because the silicon nanowire, let's say it is, you know, 5 micron long or 10 micron long, and it is, you know, covering the distance between the source and the drain, and now you put on top of this parallel nanowire structure, you know, one or two drops of blood, and the mechanical stability of these nanowires, you know, that is kind of questionable. You know, they could behave like a bamboo, they could flux, or they could break. On the other hand, the honeycomb structure offers a better mechanical stability. It also has a you know, more surface area to capture you know, enough number of molecules, you know, to produce the signals. So the first set of results that I show is pH. pH sensing is important because you know, the pH generally varies. You know, when your health conditions you know, change, there is a normal pH, and then the pH can change, you know, depending on you know, what is happening to you. So the pH sensing is very important. It is very simple and accurate way to verify the charge response of the BioFET itself. So what I'm showing here is the drain current versus the gate voltage, you know, when the pH conditions change. So the sensitivity of the, you know, this particular device is 40 millivolts, you know, per pH, you know, which is a typical value that you can expect when you use, you know, silicon dioxide as a gate material. If you happen to use some other oxide like aluminum oxide or hafnium oxide, this number can improve a little more than, you know, 40 millivolts per pH. You know, this example is detection of, you know, carcinoembryonic antigen, you know, CEA, using both the parallel nanowires and the honeycomb, you know, nanowires. The sensing limit is amazing. 5 attomoles of CEA is possible with this kind of a bio-FET. You know, that is one thing remarkable about the FET-based structures, you know, when it comes to, you know, biomedical applications, because they can provide very extraordinary, you know, sensitivity. The third example that I'm showing here is the alpha ferroprotein. This biomarker is related to, you know, tumors in the liver and testicles and ovaries in female. So the normal range is up to about, you know, 12 nanogram per ml. And so here, the current voltage curve on the left figure is the drain current versus the reference electrode, you know, voltage. So the alpha ferroprotein, when the concentration changes from 20 picogram per ml to 500 picogram per ml, the current voltage, you know, continuously shifts. So this shift in voltage is something that you can exploit, you know, to figure out, you know, what the concentration of the AFP is in a target sample. So far I talked about devices in biomedical applications when the target is in the liquid form. Okay, it could be blood or it could be urine, or if you're talking about water quality monitoring, you know, looking for E. coli and Salmonella, so it is again, you know, water. So those are all the nanoelectrode array I talked about and the bio-FET that I talked about, you know, they are for liquid samples. Lately, the medical community has been identifying biomarkers in human blood. For example, some diseases have specific biomarkers. They show up in excess concentration in the breath of sick people, you know, compared to the normal population. Some examples include like acetone in, you know, diabetes patients, NO in patients with asthma. People who undergo kidney dialysis, they exhibit excess amount of ammonia in their breath. So in all these cases, you know, we don't need the kind of, you know, devices I talked about for the liquid. What you need is a simple gas or vapor sensor that allows some type of pattern recognition. So that is good enough. I'll show you an example. A single wall carbon nanotube base, the so-called chemi resistor. So what you see here on the left image is a pair of busbar electrodes with interdigitated electrodes in between. So that could be made of a metal like platinum or gold. So it's a very easy production silicon wafer, or it could be on printed circuit board. So it's very easy to produce using simple microfabrication. It is just a two-terminal current voltage measurement. So it's very easy to make. You can do the measurements in room temperature, so you don't have to heat up or anything. So now you need some type of, you know, nanomaterial. So that nanomaterial could be carbon nanotubes, or it could be graphene, or it could be some type of, you know, nanowires. These nanowires could be zinc oxide nanowires, they could be silicon nanowires. So whatever the material is, you know, in this particular case, I'm showing, you know, carbon nanotubes, you first create a dispersion in a solvent. You know, the solvent in the case of carbon nanotubes is dimethyl formamide, okay? Now you do inkjetting of a couple of drops of this dispersion across this busbar electrodes. So you should have a good coverage of these entire electrode system, you know, with the carbon nanotubes. The right image actually shows carbon nanotubes bridging two adjacent fingers in this interdigitated electrode pattern. Here I'm showing a 1 cm by 1 cm chip, which has got 32 sensing elements. These 32 sensing elements, they are not all identical. Each of them is different. For example, one of them is just uses straightforward pure single wall carbon nanotubes. You know, some of the sensor elements may have coatings on them, and some of them may have functionalization, some of them may have metal loading, and some of them may not even be carbon nanotubes. They could be oxide nanowires, and some of them could be zinc oxide nanoparticles. So the idea here is these 32 sensors in this chip are completely different. By the way, there is nothing, you know, magical about, you know, 32. It could be smaller, you know, they could be 16 or they could be 12. The important thing here is, you know, we need a sensor array because a single sensor does not have much value. The reason for that is we are trying to create the so-called electronic nose, okay? In a mammalian nose, you know, we have, you know, thousands of cells, but these cells are not selective to any particular order. It's not like we have one cell in our nose that can only respond to coffee. Another one will respond only to chocolate. A third one will only respond to, you know, wine. There is no such thing. The way it works is, you know, one cell may respond to, you know, a bunch of different orders. One particular order may elicit signal from, you know, three or four different cells. So it is a matrix-like operation. So when it comes to chemical sensing, when it comes to construction of electronic nose, we really don't need to have, you know, thousands of sensors just to mimic a mammalian nose, you know, with thousands of cells. Because in our case, we only have one nose and we have to use it for all purposes. Whereas in the construction of electronic nose, we can construct application-specific electronic nose. So in that sense, we don't need that many sensor elements. We can live with something like, you know, 12 sensor elements. So now, you know, we take this single chip with 12 sensor elements or 36 sensor elements or whatever. In this particular case, in this view graph, I have a 32 sensor element chip. So you expose this now, you know, to the analyte of interest with a given concentration, and then you get a signal. So the signal here is with the carbon nanotube, when it is exposed to a particular ambient, the resistance of the carbon nanotube changes from the baseline. So the change in resistance normalized by the original resistance or the baseline resistance, you know, that is the quantity of interest. In the bar chart that I'm showing here at the bottom, I have 32 different responses, you know, for the 32 different sensors, you know, for a given concentration of nitric oxide, you know, 5 parts per million. So you repeat this now, you know, for 10 parts per million, 50 parts per million, 100 parts per million, you know, essentially a bunch of concentrations in the range of interest to you, okay? And then repeat the whole exercise now for different temperatures and different humidities. Now you have a massive set of data. That set of data is stored in the signal processing chip. And then later on in the interrogation mode or in the field application, you use a pattern recognition algorithm, you know, to interpolate the incoming signal and identifying the analyte of interest and its concentration. Here I'm showing you room temperature sensing of acetone. The material of choice, you know, there are many materials, but I'm showing just zinc oxide nanoparticles. They show a very good response, you know, for 1 to 50 parts per million at room temperature. And humidity effects are important because when you talk about identifying in a biomarker in human breath, mind you, human breath is full of humidity, maybe more than 95% is, you know, humidity. So trying to pick out that biomarker in a massive amount of water vapor, that is very critical.